You unlock this podcast with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of magic. A dimension of dreams. A dimension of Disney. You're moving into a realm of both wonder and fantasy, of news and ideas. You've just crossed over into Disney Coast to Coast.
Hey folks, and welcome to Disney Coast to Coast, the ultimate unofficial Disney fan podcast. I'm Jeff DePauly, and welcome to the House of Mouse headlines brought to you by LaughingPlace.com, your up-to-date resource for the latest Disney news every day of the week. This episode is being released on October 20th, 2021, and here's what's been going on in the world of Disney recently. The upcoming return of Indiana Jones to Disney's Hollywood studios, a potential Agatha Harkness Disney Plus series, a frightening new character added to Oogie Boogie Bash, and more. It's all coming your way right after this. Whether it's hats, beanies, berets, pins, jewelry, patches, scarves, stickers, tote bags, of course shirts, and so much more, you can find all of this magically inspired apparel over at Whosits and Whatsits. If it's been a while since you've checked out Whosits and Whatsits, now is the time as they've added a bunch of new Disney-inspired merchandise recently. And Disney Coast to Coast listeners save 15% simply by using code DCTC when checking out. So go ahead and click on the link in this episode's description, and don't forget to use code DCTC at checkout and save 15% on anything and everything you purchase.
Hear the latest news from the Walt Disney Company in today's House of Mouse headlines.
In some sad news, Disney legend Ruthie Thompson passed away this week at the age of 111. Thompson enjoyed a 40-year career with Disney, working on numerous Disney animated features from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs to The Rescuers and several in between. She was named an official Disney legend in 2000. In a remembrance, Walt Disney Company Executive Chairman Bob Iger said, "Ruthie was a legend among animators, and her creative contributions to Disney remain beloved classics to this day. While we will miss her smile and wonderful sense of humor, her exceptional work and pioneering spirit will forever be an inspiration to us all." One of the Disneyland Resort's most iconic features has returned. As of last week, the Disneyland monorail has resumed daily operation. Although the resort's monorail line isn't as essential of a mode of transportation as those at Walt Disney World, it's still a convenient and fun way for guests to travel from downtown Disney right into Tomorrowland and vice versa. So get ready to ride the Disneyland monorail once again, and don't forget your required face covering while on board. Just as Avengers Campus has continued to update its character interactions to reflect the latest happenings in the MCU, Oogie Boogie Bash at Disney California Adventure is also seeing a late addition. Now, guests might spot a zombie version of Captain America as featured in Marvel's What If. While he still retains his iconic suit and shield, his outfit is a little worse for the wear and has taken on some undead characteristics. And if this entire premise is confusing to you, then you may want to check out Marvel's What If, streaming now on Disney+. With the holidays at the Disneyland Resort kicking off on November 12th, the resort has shared a sneak preview of this year's celebration, including new merchandise and costumes for Mickey and Minnie Mouse. This year, the duo will don new winter wear as they greet guests in Town Square. What's more, magic key holders will have the opportunity to meet Mickey and Minnie in their updated outfits first at the limited-time Starcade experience through October 30th. Then, plush collectibles of the pair wearing similar outfits will also hit store shelves this season. The holidays at the Disneyland Resort will run from November 12th to January 9th, 2022. Disney Very Merriest After Hours at Magic Kingdom will feature even more festive fun as Mickey and Minnie's Very Merry Memories will join the event's entertainment lineup. According to the Disney Parks blog, this new show that will perform on the Cinderella Castle forecourt stage will see Mickey and his pals joining for a celebration filled with music, dancing, and nostalgic Yuletide fun. The show will feature nods to classic Magic Kingdom holiday stage shows including Mickey's Twas the Night Before Christmas, Celebrate the Season, and Mickey's Most Merriest Celebration. Tickets for Disney Very Merriest After Hours are now on sale, ranging from $169 to $249 per adult, depending on the date. As previously and excitingly announced, Candlelight Processional will be returning to Epcot this year as part of the Epcot International Festival of the Holidays. Now, the Disney Parks blog has revealed some of the celebrity narrators that will participate in this year's festivities. While a full schedule is not yet available, we do know that Cheetah Rivera, Jodie Benson, Alton Fitzgerald White, Lisa Ling, Stephen Curtis Chapman, Blair Underwood, and Pat Sajak will be among those appearing. Of course, this schedule is subject to change, and more dates will be announced soon. Those looking to get a guaranteed seat for one of these performances will also be happy to know that Candlelight Processional dining packages will be available to book online beginning October 26th. For more information, be sure to check out Walt Disney World's website. At the time you're hearing this, the new Disney Genie service has launched at Walt Disney World. This complimentary service will allow guests to plan their day in the parks, including attraction recommendations based on location and wait time, restaurant suggestions based on reservation or mobile order availability, and more. Of course, while Disney Genie itself is free, the majority of the chatter has been about the paid upgrades, including Disney Genie Plus and individual Lightning Lane selections. At Walt Disney World, Disney Genie Plus will cost $15 per person per day and allow guests to book return times for certain attractions, akin to the former MaxPass system at Disneyland. On top of that, the two most popular attractions at each park will offer a separate system where guests can pay a one-time fee to access the attraction via Lightning Lane. These individual attraction purchases are limited to two per guest per day and feature attractions not included in the Genie Plus product. Meanwhile, no launch date for the Disneyland Resort versions of these platforms has been announced just yet, but a list of Genie Plus and individual Lightning Lane attractions can be found on the resort's website. Earlier this year, it was announced that Disney would be updating its Disability Access Service, or DAS. Now, one of those changes has taken place, as guests will have the option to apply for DAS via a virtual chat session with a cast member before their arrival. Alternatively, they can still obtain a DAS in person at guest relations during a park visit. Currently, however, the pre-visit option is only available for visits on or after November 1st, 2021. More information, including details on the new option, can be found on Walt Disney World's Disability Access Service website. Over at Disneyland Paris, another paid upgrade feature is also now live. With the return of the Lion King Rhythms of the Pride Land show on October 23rd, the park is now offering a guaranteed seating option. Guests can book reservations for performances at a cost of €15 per person. However, a limited number of these guaranteed seats will be sold, and access via a standby queue will still be available. This new service follows the debut of Premier Access this summer. Incidentally, guests recently noticed that the price range for that service fell in recent weeks, now seemingly costing between €5 and €12 instead of the original €8 to €15. Do either of these changes signal what we could see here at home? We'll have to stay tuned and see. In some theme park slash comic news, Marvel is launching a new 5-issue miniseries titled Star Wars Halcyon Legacy, tying into the Star Wars Galactic Star Cruiser experience coming to Walt Disney World. The comic will be written by Ethan Sachs and feature art from Will Sliney, with the duo previously working on the Star Wars Galaxy's Edge comic miniseries together. This upcoming series will span centuries, allowing readers to visit the Halcyon in different points in the Star Wars timeline, and feature familiar characters such as Lando Calrissian and Hondo Ohnaka. While Star Wars Halcyon Legacy will debut next year, general bookings for Galactic Star Cruiser open on October 28th. Star Wars fans across the galaxy can grow their most impressive collections with even more amazing Star Wars merchandise as Disney and Lucasfilm present Bring Home the Bounty. Every Tuesday from now through December 28th, fans can look for new products and content from licensees like Hasbro, the Lego Group, Funko, Mattel, and many more. These items will be revealed each Tuesday at 6 a.m. Pacific, with select pre-orders starting Wednesdays at 10 a.m. Pacific. Not by coincidence, this promotion will lead right into the debut of The Book of Boba Fett on Disney Plus, December 29th. So prepare your wallets and be sure to visit StarWars.com every week for the latest products to purchase. Following the success of ABC's Disney Family Sing-Along specials last year, the network has another one slated to premiere next month, but with a twist. This time around, performers will be taking on the songbook of the iconic rock band Queen. The Queen Family Sing-Along will be hosted by Glee alum Darren Criss and feature Adam Lambert, Derek Hough and Alexander Jean, Fall Out Boy, Pentatonix, Jimmy Allen with Miss Piggy, and more. Plus, cast members from Disney Theatricals' The Lion King and Aladdin will come together for a performance of Don't Stop Me Now in celebration of Broadway's reopening. The Queen Family Sing-Along will air on Thursday, November 4th at 8 p.m. on ABC. Speaking of ABC, the Alphabet Network is once again bringing back its Wonderful World of Disney banner for a double dose of Toy Story fun. On Thursday, October 28th, fans can catch a re-airing of Toy Story of Terror at 8 p.m., followed by the broadcast premiere of Toy Story 4. Of course, if you can't wait until then, you can stream both the special and the film right now on Disney+. And now it's time to bring in Kyle Burbank from LaughingPlace.com. How you doing, my friend?
I'm doing great. How about you, Jeff?
I'm doing pretty good, but I got a question for you, Kyle.
Okay.
Who's been messing up everything?
I think it's been Agatha all along.
Very good. I didn't even have to go to the second line. Who's been pulling every evil string? It was Agatha all along.
Bum, 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 bum.
And why are we singing random TV theme songs? Because according to Variety, there is a WandaVision spinoff in the works for Disney+, all about Agatha Harkness. I can't imagine anybody's upset by this news. This is fantastic.
Yeah, this is really unexpected and great.
Is
it? I think it's unexpected, but I think it makes a lot of sense once you stop and think about kind of the new dynamic that we're in with the MCU, to where, you know, one of their problems has been that their villains never really stood out because we never had enough time with them. And then when they kind of did with, like, Thanos, where you had them over all these movies, that was one of the stronger villains. So being able to have a series where we're going to see Agatha go from presumably where she was in WandaVision to presumably where she'll be the next time we see her, I think adds a lot to it and will make whatever appearance she has in subsequent films a lot stronger.
See, you just put a lot more thought into it than me. For me, it was simply, this is something that hit the public really strong, became very popular. So of course there needs to be a spinoff in the mind of Disney and Marvel, right? Like, there's too many dollars to be made not to do this. And frankly, like, I couldn't be happier for Catherine Hahn. Listen, I know a lot of people knew this actress before WandaVision. I had no idea who she was, even though after I went back and looked at her resume, I had seen a lot of the stuff she was in. She just never stood out to me. It just feels like a Cinderella story to me, like this woman who had been a working actress for a long time, but like hadn't really hit that moment. And a lot of times people never hit that moment, but like she did. I'm thrilled for her. She's coming back for this. If she wasn't, gosh, I hope they would be smart enough not to do it, but she's going to come back. And I think this is great. Like, I'm excited, and it's Marvel news, and I'm excited. So they're hitting a huge demographic, I think, that Marvel doesn't always hit.
That's quite a testament. That's a really good point. And I will say, I think before WandaVision, she was probably most famous for being someone that people mistook for Anna Gasteyer.
Yes, she does have kind of that vibe. She definitely looks like she could be her sister, for sure. And yeah, I just love her. I'm excited about this. The series is being described as a dark comedy, perfect for her style of acting. And but we don't have exact plot details yet at this time. Jas Schaefer, the head writer for WandaVision, is attached to write and executive produce the new Agatha series. And yeah, I don't know where the story's going to go. To me, like, part of the fun was watching Catherine Hahn play these different decades, like these sitcom decades. I don't think we'll be getting that. I think it'll basically be, you know, evil Agatha that we got at the end of the series, which wasn't my favorite version of Agatha, but regardless, I'm excited for her to, like, wreak all havoc, you know?
Well, spoilers, but she does get put back into that Agnes role at the end, so there could be some room for kind of her having a similar awakening like Wanda did. So I wouldn't rule out some decade play.
I'll tell you what, I think it was the first episode and maybe the second as well for WandaVision, like they actually shot in front of a live studio audience. Mm-hmm. If they do that with any of, you know, Agatha's show, I will be fighting for those audience tickets. Like, I would love to see her live in person doing her thing. I think she's so damn good. I love her. So there's that. Do you think we get a new theme song, or are we sticking with Agatha all along?
That's honestly been one of the biggest questions that I've gotten from people when they've heard about this. It seems like they'd have to incorporate that bop of a song somehow.
Yeah, I do think we'll get like a new something, new version of it, but I definitely think
a Fall Out Boy cover.
A Fall Out Boy cover.
I mean, they practically, because it's like the Munsters and they have that song that samples the Munsters. So it's like, gotcha, it's gotcha. Right there.
Okay, sure. Fall Out Boy cover. Let's do it. But yeah, I think we'll get a sampling of Agatha All Along. It's a hit. It's a bop, as the kids say and as you say. So there we go. But it's great news. Let's move on. We got Alan Horn, the chief creative officer of Disney Studios Content, who's been there for 9 years at Disney and in the entertainment industry for almost 50 years. He's announced that he'll be retiring from the company effective December 31st, 2021. Now, I know Alan Horn from my days at WB, my many years working at Warner Brothers. He was obviously, you know, I was a minion there and he was the guy in charge or one
that
of the guys
long
in charge.
Studio, Jeff, that's Universal.
What was that?
You said you were a minion. That's Universal.
Oh, yes. What would I be at Warner Brothers then? What's the equivalent of a minion at WB?
A Looney Tune.
A Looney Tune. Sure. I was a Looney Tune. All right. And he was Alan Horn running the place with some other people. And he was a really nice guy. Like, I would run into him. He was a cool, nice guy. He brought Harry Potter to the studio, I believe. I know he was like really, he was there during that time. And I think he was one of the people really responsible for that. And I don't know, like when his contract ended there, they kind of like got rid of him, didn't renew it. I was like, what are they doing? It was very weird, but I always loved Alan Horn. So honestly, when he came to Disney, I was like, this is great. Like, this is a good guy who knows what he's doing. And under Horn's leadership, the Walt Disney Studios set numerous records at the box office, surpassing $7 billion globally in 2016 and 2018, and $11 billion in 2019, the only studio ever to have reached those thresholds. So, do you have any opinions on Alan Horn?
I don't. It's not... because I feel one way or the other. It's just I'm not 100% familiar with him. I definitely have heard the name. He's been around for a while at Disney. And then as far as this retirement, I thought that this was already announced. Like maybe there was already discussion about it. So when I saw the release go out that it was official, I had to double check. Like, did we already know this? But I guess not. So,
well, that's interesting because I'm actually really curious if he's retiring or if he's being pushed out. Because I guess last December, Alan Bergman replaced Horn as Disney Studios content chairman after co-running the division together since May of 2019. So, I mean, there's been a lot of talk recently about Bob Chapek reshuffling leadership roles, getting out the more creative Iger set people and bringing in more of his spreadsheet people. So, I thought maybe that was that. But also, Alan Horn, because when the WB thing happened with Alan Horn, it was kind of like played off as a retirement situation as well. Mm. That's why I immediately thought, I was like, is this his choice or is this kind of a, you know, reworking of the guard sort of situation?
Yeah. And as they kind of point out, he's not being replaced because all of the studios, all the brands that Disney has now all kind of have their own creative leaders. Like you have Pete Docter and Jennifer Lee and Kevin Feige and Kathy Kennedy. So, I mean, he's kind of almost like he was almost an emeritus position already. So it kind of makes sense that he would, I mean, yeah, he's leaving. I think his last day is the exact same day as Iger, right?
As Bob Iger, yeah. So, and did you read the article, the Hollywood Reporter article?
Yeah.
Dude, that was, I mean, nothing surprising about it, but harsh as far as the Iger-Chapek relationship. And you know, I made a comment on the show that I ended up deleting to you because I was like, I don't want to start rumors, but the whole comment I made to you at one point about apparently Iger and Chapek, like, they try to keep them separate because they're are arguing so much these days. After reading that article, I was like, you know what, this ain't rumor anymore as far as I'm concerned. I mean, like, this is a bad
situation. It's still rumor. I don't even think they're working in office, so I don't know how they could keep them separated. They're already kind of separated.
Well, supposedly at Walt Disney World for the 50th, they were, like, kept separate, like, purposefully. So, I don't know. Interesting, nasty situation, not fun, and I think everybody knows how I feel about the leadership at this point, so no need to go into it. But, yeah, it's really good when the gossip's in the Hollywood Reporter. It's not a good look for the studio, but shall we move on or would you like to add anything, Kyle?
I think I'm good. People can go read it. I think the artwork is the best part of the article, though.
I'll include a link in the show notes to the Hollywood Reporter article. It is interesting if you have any interest in the business side of Disney. It's fascinating. So anyway, let's move on because there are modified character meeting experiences returning this November at Walt Disney World. Starting in November, you'll be able to once again meet with your favorite Disney princesses at Princess Fairy Tale Hall in the Magic Kingdom. And then Mickey Mouse will be wearing his all-new look for the 50th anniversary celebration when you meet him at Town Square Theater on Main Street, USA. Over at Disney's Hollywood Studios, you'll find the stars of Disney Jr. over in the Animation Courtyard, while Minnie Mouse will be meeting at Red Carpet Dreams. And at this time, hugs and autographs will not be allowed. However, guests will be able to meet and snap a picture with the characters. So this is like some return to normalcy, but not quite. I'm sensitive to like the whole COVID being safe thing, but I feel like this is one of the safest things for like non-face characters. How much protection do you need to stand next to a kid and take a photo and sign an autograph? Is this a union thing? I'm not quite getting.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's just a mixed message to be able to hug them, even if it is, you know, with the mask and stuff. I mean, you make a good point. I think it just, it probably would just feel uncomfortable for the characters, even if they are presumably safe. It probably, like, it's weird just hugging your friends these days. So I'm sure just having a bunch of little kids run up to you constantly and hug you is probably not a comfortable thing.
I mean, if you can be a cashier or any other, you know, face to guest cast member, I feel like they're in a lot worse positions than Mickey Mouse. I don't know. It just, I'm thinking maybe it's a union thing. I don't think those positions are union in Florida, so I guess that wouldn't make sense. I don't know. I'm a little surprised by this. We're in this period of what COVID protocol is going to just be the new norm moving forward. And there are certain things that Disney's doing that I'm like, really? Like, we're still not back there. This is one of them. The other is the trams at Disneyland. I cannot believe that they're still having people walk from Mickey and Friends to the parks, which is like a good 20-minute walk, which, honestly, I don't mind at the beginning of the day. The end of the day, it's a bit of a hassle. But like, there are many times I've opted to do the walk instead of wait for a tram. But I think I am in the minority. And I'm shocked that this hasn't become a bigger problem than just like people complaining a bit on Twitter. I don't know. It's bizarre to me. And I can't believe, I mean, it's an open air vehicle. The monorail is back. It's bizarre to me.
Yeah, that is a weird one. I mean, I don't remember the last time I took the tram because I always hated them, especially once they put the doors on. Like, I just thought that was stupid. But yeah, that is definitely weird. And same thing at Walt Disney World. I don't think they have their trams either.
I mean, that has to be a staffing issue. That's all that must come down to. But I don't know. I feel like that's kind of an important one. And I know they've started asking in surveys people like, does this ruin your experience not having the tram? And if you get that survey, say yes, it does ruin my experience, because I think those need to come back. I think it's kind of crazy. And I just think of so many people I go with that like really complain about just walking in general at a Disney park, and just the walk from the, you know, parking garage to the park, an extra 20 minutes is just crazy to me. But in any case, one of the interesting things, though, talking about things that might not ever go away, that would actually be a good thing that we've gotten from the COVID-19 situation, are these cavalcades. Apparently are keeping some of those around, which I think is great. I really like these cavalcades. I've become a fan of them. I just hope they don't replace parades, which I don't think they will. Parades are slowly coming back. But I think this is kind of cool.
Yeah, I like cavalcades, and I agree. I think we should keep parades as well, but it is nice to just like have a short little cavalcade and then be able to move on with your day. It does suck getting stuck somewhere by a parade, so it's been kind of nice for getting around the parks and just having these short little bursts where you don't have to clear out. They don't close off the section quite as early, but I think each one's fun. Like, we watched a few of them at the whatever the after hours party was at Magic Kingdom for Halloween.
Boobash?
Yeah, Boobash. And those were all fun. They played different section of the music each time one came by. So I felt like I got a little bit of boo to you from that. So,
yeah. Excellent. So that's happening. Speaking of the cavalcades and entertainment, we got more entertainment returning to Walt Disney World. The Indiana Jones Epic Stunt Spectacular will be returning to the stage at Disney's Hollywood Studios on December 19th. Are you excited for this, Kyle? Because I am.
I can't tell you the last time I saw it. Just like I can't remember the last time I rode a tram, definitely can't tell you the last time I saw this show. I must have been like 8 years old.
It's honestly a must-see for me. And for me, it's super nostalgic. It's like one of the, you know, I know it wasn't their opening day, but still an opening year attraction for the park. I love it. I hope they do something. I don't know if we'll get updates immediately this time around, but I hope they do something when the new film comes out. And I hope that they keep it alive, you know.
Well, on that note, the movie just got pushed back another year, so.
Oh, jeez. Come on, Harrison Ford is going to be dead. This is not fair.
They're filming it now, so I don't know what the holdup is, but yeah, they just pushed it to June 2023. This movie was originally supposed to open in 2019.
What was the reasoning?
They didn't say. They just released their new slate. They pushed back a bunch of Marvels and then moved back indie.
Oh, man. Crazy, crazy. Well, the show's coming back. I think that's great. I hope it gets reworked. And yeah, I'm happy to see that that's returning. And obviously, it sucks up a huge crowd in the park. So it's just good for the park in general. We also get Disney Movie Magic, the cinematic nighttime experience celebrating Disney's live action film legacy, returning on November 7th. This is the projection mapping show on the Chinese theater. But this time around, speaking of updates, the nighttime show will feature a brand new sequence from Disney's live action remake of Mulan. Have you ever gotten to see this in person?
No, I haven't.
I believe, if I'm remembering correctly, there's some Newsies in there and some Hocus Pocus in there. I don't think any Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, which is honestly obnoxious if that's the case. But some cool little deep cuts, which I appreciate.
Yeah, I think you sound correct in that. But yeah, I'll have to see. I actually kind of forgot that this was a thing because they've had a few of these different projection shows. So I kind of lost track of them, honestly.
Yeah, it kind of got replaced pretty quickly by the animation one. And it was weird because it kind of like was played before or after the big Star Wars nighttime spectacular. So it was one of those things that it was like kind of like a cavalcade. Like it's there, but you don't really plan your day around it. It just kind of happens. So that's kind of cool. That's coming back over at Disney's Animal Kingdom. Guests can once again enjoy the music of Chakranati in Asia. Is that how you Chakranati? Chakranati, let's say it that way. And then Cora Tinga Tinga has also returned to the streets of Harambe in Africa, while the Tam Tam Drummers will return in early November. It's all great news. Live entertainment is returning. This is great news. So I'm all for it.
This is what we've been waiting for. You said it as soon as everything got shut down, that you really hope this stuff returns. And a lot of people were skeptical. But, you know, I don't think it's everything yet, but it's getting there.
It is indeed getting there. And I do want to touch on a story that I talked about earlier in the news. And that's just the zombie Captain America at Oogie Boogie Bash. This is bonkers to me. And it just makes me think of, I'm curious, have you heard about when Marvel Superhero Island at Islands of Adventure was part of Halloween Horror Nights?
No, I haven't.
Okay. In 2002, they did Halloween Horror Nights in Islands and or maybe both parks. I think there were a year or two where they did it in both parks. But apparently, when they built these mazes and such, like, they killed a lot of the superheroes. And Marvel had a fit. And they were like, you cannot kill Spider-Man or Captain America or whatever. And like, so it was never done again. It was a big problem. So I find it kind of ironic that we now have a zombie Captain America in a Disney park.
Well, he's not dead. He's undead.
Ah, there we go.
Loophole. And it ties directly into their project, which, by the way, if you haven't seen What If, and I'm sure you personally have not, but the zombie episode was among the best. It was a lot of fun and really stands on its own from the rest of the series.
It's an animated series, right?
Yeah. But it has a lot of repeating, not entirely the same voice talent, but a lot of returning voice talent.
Is it one of those things that, like, if you haven't seen the movies, are you just going to be confused? Or
I mean, they definitely reference the movies, some more than others. But this one in particular, I think you could probably watch on its own and just be like, this is, you know, I know these Marvel characters and some of them are zombies and fighting zombies.
Speaking of referencing past movies, have you seen Halloween Kills?
No, I have never seen a Halloween movie.
Oh, Kyle Burbank, you are missing out. Although Halloween Kills was just okay, but the franchise in general, fun. In any case, before we go, do you want to let folks know where you're going to be going in May?
Oh, and not in May, in March.
Oh, in March you're going. I thought in May you were going. You're
no,
going
I have a friend going on May 4th, but I am going on the Galactic Star Cruiser at the end of March.
Jeez Louise, Kyle Burbank. You did it.
my friends wanted to go and I didn't want to be a bummer. And no, it actually sounds kind of nice because we're usually working anytime we travel. So this will be the first time since our honeymoon we're actually like vacationing without doing anything for at least a couple of days. So yeah, I mean, we're splitting one standard room between four adults.
So that's typically meant for two adults.
It sleeps five.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, it costs more for five adults or for four adults, obviously. In terms of like versus whether because it's all inclusive with the meals and everything, so you have to tell them who's staying with you for that reason. So yeah, I'll tell you, it came out to $6,600 total,
divided by four.
Divided by four. Okay. That was not my share, but yeah, it's still very pricey and. Wow. It not something we swallowed lightly, but I'm excited for it, and I hope it works out.
Well, I hope you come on the show to talk about it, because I definitely will not be spending anywhere near that money to experience that. That's not a deal. But I was a little surprised when I got that text from you. You're like, so I'm going to a galaxy far, far away. I was like, what?
We were debating it for a while. And then we're like, all right, let's see if we can even get the reservation. And then we managed to get the reservation. So I'll tell you, it's also even more if you go on a weekend. It was going to be like another $500 if we went on a weekend.
Now, did you actually go through the headache of making the reservation, or did your friend
not
do that?
Okay. I am not an annual pass holder for Walt Disney World, so my friend was able to book it for us. Although, she had a better time than some of my other friends who also tried. It sounded like she was having a hard time getting through it first, but then once she actually got someone to pick up, then it was only about 90 minutes, and they also did like a little pre-screening thing that seemed to help the process. But it's when it was by the phone, it takes a while because you have to find your dates, and then you have to book your reservations for dining separately, even though they're included. It's kind of a mess, but...
Yeah, I mean, it's becoming more and more crazy/difficult, I think, to take a Disney vacation. And it's always been that way. It's a pre-planning type of trip, but I don't know. Even, like, when I just hear about Disney Genie, Genie Plus, and all that stuff, I'm like, I don't think I'll ever use it, just because it sounds annoying to me, to be completely honest. Just, you know, the whole process, so... I don't know, but I guess I'm lucky enough to go frequent enough that I can just walk in and do what I want and, you know, not feel like I need to hit everything. So maybe for those I need to hit everything people, maybe that'll all work out. We'll see. But cool. Anyway, that's the news this week. Anything you want to add, Kyle?
I don't think so.
Is this the last time I'll be talking to you before Halloween? I think so.
I guess so, yes.
It'll
be November
gosh.
Next time we talk. That's kind of crazy.
Kyle, happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween to you too, and congratulations on completing another season of your podcast.
Yeah, I mean, I'm deep in the editing right now, but yes, that Halloween podcast is still going. I'm quite exhausted by it, and I've been going to a lot of Halloween events this year, and I'm, you know, really enjoying myself. There's only one that I've gone to that I was like, that is a complete waste of time. Otherwise, some really nice surprises along the way. So it's been a good season, and I know you've done none of that, so I'm doing it for you.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Happy Halloweeny, happy best day of the year, and I'll talk to you again in November.
All right, looking forward to it.
To read more about any and all of the stories you've heard here today, simply visit the show note links in this episode's description. You've heard the news, and now I want to hear what you have to say about it. Share your thoughts on any topics mentioned in today's episode by calling 818-860-2569, and you may just hear yourself on a future episode of Disney Coast to Coast. On the previous episode of Disney Coast to Coast, we started our Halloween fun for the season, and next week it's all about Muppet's Haunted Mansion with a very special guest. The easiest way to make sure you don't miss any of the magic is by subscribing to Disney Coast to Coast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Wherever you search, don't forget, it's Disney with a Z, Coast to Coast. This episode has been executive produced by Robert Scontrino. Gain rewards like Robert by visiting patreon.com/DisneyWithAZCTC. That link, plus the DCTC hotline and some free gifts from me to you, can all be found in this episode's description. Other than that, folks, have a magical day. Bye!
Thanks for listening to Disney Coast to Coast. Have a magical day!
Disney Coast to Coast is produced and hosted by Jeff DePauly. Learn more about the podcast and become a supporter at DisneyCoastToCoast.com.
This podcast is part of the DePodcast Network. Learn more about this show, plus find more quality and entertaining podcasts at DePodcastNetwork.com. That's DePodcastNetwork.com.